Good morning and welcome to Cross Lanes United Methodist Church virtual worship for January 31st, 2021. I'm Pastor Krista Rexrode Wolf in Cross Lanes, West Virginia, and I want to welcome you in the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are in the season of Epiphany in the Christian church, and in this season at Cross Lanes, we are remembering that God keeps getting found because God wants to be found. We can trust in this season that God has not abandoned us, that God has not gone anywhere, and in fact, God is among us. This morning, we're going to begin our worship with an opening prayer, and as I lead that opening prayer, I encourage you to keep your eyes open so that you can participate with me by reading along the prayer as it appears on your screen. Let us pray. Holy God, help us to prioritize our relationships over our desire to be right. Help us employ our reason to create connection. When reason fails to create connection, help us rely on love. Amen. As we set our hearts into a posture of worship this morning, I'd like to invite the children to a time that's set aside just for them. Every week, we explore the scripture with our youngest disciples. We call this our children's sermon. And so I want to invite the children in your household to come and join me. Hello, friends. It's so good to see all of you. Our Bible story today comes from the book of 1 Corinthians in the New Testament. 1 Corinthians is one of those books of the Bible that is actually a letter. The books in the Bible that are actually letters are written to people to teach them how to do, be, and practice what they believe. Today, Paul is writing to a church in the city of Corinth. At this time, the church had a decision to make. They had to decide if they were going to eat food that was not so good for them. Paul reminds them that they don't have to make their choices alone. They can help each other make good choices, because making choices is really hard. And for us now, it's still hard. And it starts as soon as we wake up. When we get up, do we brush our teeth first or play Legos? Do we eat breakfast or put our shoes on? When we get home, it doesn't get any easier. Should we go ahead and start our homework or eat a snack? Do you ever feel overwhelmed when you have a choice to make? Me too. It can be easier to make choices when we know what to expect. I know a lot of folks who use charts to help them map out their choices, the choices that they have to make every day. And maybe it would help you too. They call these a first then chart. Take a look here. Yeah, it shows you can work with your grown-ups and you can talk with them about what you should do first and then what you can do next. Planning with each other can help you feel good about your decisions. Do you see some of these things? These are things you might do every day, but maybe it's best to do them in a certain order. With your grown-up, you can stop, think, and choose together. When you do that together, you can feel confident that what you are doing is healthy and safe. We won't always be able to guess every decision we have to make in a day, but it is good to practice good choices with the decisions we know we will have to make. So I hope it's something you'll try out this week. If you want to download this chart, you can do so on our website, crosslanesumc.org, or you can make your own first then chart. But for now, we're going to pray that God will be with us when we make decisions through the week. Here at Cross Lanes United Methodist Church, when we pray, we start with our hands far apart, and then we clap them together, and you can repeat after me. Dear God, help us make good choices. Amen. It was good to be with you today, friends.
Our lesson today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 to 13. Now concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge. Since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their falling, I will never eat meat, so that I may not cause one of them to fall. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The Corinthian people wanted to know what constituted holy living, how to be, do, and practice Christianity in a culture largely at odds with Jesus' nature of justice, equity, grace, and joy. Corinth was a wealthy city, but the wealth resided in a small portion of the population, with poverty shared by most citizens. It was a city under Roman occupation, but given special privilege as a trade post between Corinth and the small land bridge that connected Corinth to the mainland of Greece. Corinth was a culture that gave deference to a caste system in which people could not rise above their station. And so by Paul's design, there were in the church people from every station, Gentiles and Jews, the wealthy and the poor. And they were trying to wrap their minds around how all of them were expected to live under the same rules, and, in fact, if they had rules at all. Paul had told Christians that they did not first have to become Jewish and did not have to follow Jewish law in order to convert or share the gospel of Jesus Christ. To some of Paul's folks, this sounded like permission to keep living the privileged life of a Roman citizen in a wealthy city with little change. As Paul's comments seem to indicate, there was in fact a strong faction of the Corinthian church that was well-educated, well-to-do, and relatively sophisticated, who believed that Christians should be free to eat meat offered to idols. And their reason is fairly simple. Idols do not exist and therefore have no power, since there is no God but one. Now, for these people, this is obvious. They're in the know, and everyone who's in the know knows that there is no harm in eating the meat because it's just meat. And to them, in the end, they were breaking no Roman law. They were not really worshiping any other gods because no such gods existed. For them, this was about social life, right? Social life demanded that they be present at the frequent feasts and banquets and celebrations and public events held in the dining spaces related to idol temples. And they shopped in the meat markets connected with those same temples for their own private households. It was a free country. They were free people with the liberty to eat, drink, buy, and sell on the market as they wished. And Paul agreed with them up to a point. He agreed that food had no salvific or damning qualities on its own. He also agreed that these Christians were free of Jewish food laws that would prevent them from eating temple meat. He even agreed with their logic. They could not worship an idol god because idol gods did not exist. And yet, Paul confronts this practice of eating temple meat because it's not just about meat. It's about living as disciples with the intentions of expanding a Jesus-loving community. Paul put it this way, and I'm just going to share some highlights from our scripture this morning. He said, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. It is not everyone who has this knowledge, since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. This bit of pastoral advice is one among many times that Paul takes care to nuance his understanding of freedom in Christ. In Romans chapters 6 through 8, Paul discusses freedom in terms of baptism and adoption. He says in chapter 6, verse 1, "So what are we going to say? Should we continue sinning so grace will multiply? Absolutely not." Then he describes the baptism of Christians as a sharing in Christ's death and resurrection. Those who are baptized have left one kind of life behind and have entered the freedom from sin offered in their new resurrected lives. To enter freedom from sin and to enter freedom from the law was to automatically enter new life in the Spirit. And that life requires Christians to lay down selfishness and self-centered action. In Galatians 5 and 6, Paul discusses freedom again in terms of fruitfulness. He says in chapter 5, verses 13 to 15, "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. However, if you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another." Freedom in Galatians is the pursuit of service, and the evidence of freedom is not apathy or self-indulgence. It is described in chapter 5, verse 22 as love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. It is the freedom to imitate Christ, who laid down his life for his friends. While the Corinthian church wouldn't have had access to Paul's other writings, there is a pattern here. For Christians, according to Paul, freedom isn't doing whatever you want. Liberty to do as one pleased was certainly available to the citizens of Rome. Eating temple meat was certainly a freedom practiced by citizens of wealth. But for Paul, participating in this kind of dangerous use of liberty and freedom was not wise for the citizens of the kingdom of God, whose mission was to love the Lord their God with all their heart, all their mind, and all their soul, and their neighbor as themselves. Freedom meant that Christians finally had a choice. Where once they were enslaved by sin and death, they were now at liberty to choose a different, more loving, and holier way of life. It was a freedom to relinquish or redistribute certain rights so that everyone could share life abundant. In Corinth, those in the know may have understood that idol meat was harmless. But when Christians engaged in that cultural practice, they put new converts in danger of returning to more damaging idolatrous behavior. And they signaled to the larger community that their faith didn't require any particular discipline. And Paul wanted to caution Corinthian Christians against wielding their knowledge of the one true God in ways that excused them from responsibility to their vulnerable and attentive neighbors. Because what was a liberating force for some had the power to destroy others. Knowledge, according to Paul, should not be leveraged as a weapon against the very people for whom Christ died. As the scripture goes, Paul was really uninterested in appeals to individual rights when the well-being of others was at stake. How would they build a Jesus community if they didn't look any different, act any different, love any differently than those in the Roman community? How could they be disciples of the Lord Jesus and still enjoy the ways of Lord Nero? Paul told the Corinthian church that the best, most loving way to witness to Jesus Christ in Corinth was to love their neighbor in a way that built community, that accommodated the most vulnerable members of their culture, and that exercised discipline. In other words, they couldn't expect to eat the food of idols and then wonder why no one knew which God they served. Their actions, no matter their intention or their knowledge, were a witness to the God they believed in. When I read this scripture, it reminded me of every time I have ever heard my children repeat my own words back to me, and doing so much more deftly than I would prefer. When my daughter was maybe 2, I was giving her a bath and it began to storm outside. So I hurriedly finished up her bath and I told her that we had to get out quickly because it's not safe to take a bath during a thunderstorm. Honest to God, 2 years later, we were fighting about bath time. I'd had a long day. I needed her to bathe and cooperate so that we could get on with bedtime. And she did not want to get in. She was making me chase her around the house. And as we fought, there was a crack of thunder in the background. She stopped immediately, turned around and said, "I can't bath in a thunderstorm." Kids remember everything, and they see everything, and they repeat everything. There are plenty of perfectly legal, allowable things I can say and do. Cursing when I stub my toe, skipping my vegetables at dinner, procrastinating work. Those things are perfectly legal, allowable things. I don't necessarily want my children to repeat them. The same kind of thing, I think, is what Paul is getting at here. Our actions are being watched, and it doesn't end in our homes. Churches will always be faced with questions about what love requires of us. Christians have to decide how we will wield our knowledge of Christ in public, how we will accommodate the most vulnerable members of our culture, how we will discipline our liberty, how we will witness to the God we serve. Should we suspend in-person worship when we have every right and freedom to meet as we desire? Should Christians refrain from drinking, particularly in public? Should we shop on the Sabbath? These are basic questions that we encounter as Christian people in the 21st century every day. And reading this scripture doesn't mean there are clear-cut answers to modern questions of ethics and advocacy. But it does help us remember, like it or not, our actions are an example to others. And our own freedom to act must be constrained by its possible influence on others. Our liberty must be disciplined by the common welfare. To be like Christ is to relinquish some of what we can technically do as citizens of this country in order to enter a new life in the Spirit, a bond of love and care in the kingdom of God with all for whom Christ died. My prayer today is that we might let 1 Corinthians 8 trouble us, that it might be a scripture of meditation. My prayer for this community, for Cross Lanes United Methodist Church, is that as we go about our day, making our choices, that it might be clear who we serve, that we may be disciples who build others up in love, and that we might be guided by a freedom unafraid of discipline. Amen. This scripture gives us much to think about. There are many ways to respond to the Word of God. If you're looking for an opportunity to respond to the Word of God with your service, your witness, and your financial gifts, you can go to crosslanesumc.org to check out our event calendar or to find ways to interact with church staff. Brothers and sisters, I'm so glad to have spent this time with you. We've shared in the good news of the gospel. God is found because God wants to be found. Now go forth as those equipped to build up in love. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Better is one day.